I started my career in the financial services sector. I worked on Wall Street for a little while for a firm called Schuster & Lehman Brothers. I worked for Chase Manhattan Bank for a while. And then, believe it or not, I jumped out of there. I wasn't feeling the kind of success and purpose that I needed to really strive in terms of leadership and where I wanted to go with that. But I didn't feel like I was really helping people. And I love to travel, so I moved off, jumped off, started working at British Airways. And I think for me, in terms of leadership there, I tended to think other people thought exactly like me. And so that was a tremendous learning curve for me up front. Back then, Paul might be familiar with this, we had something called Colors Insights, which we did back at BA, and it helped you really discover your personality traits, and then really, more importantly, that of others. And it almost really opened up my whole world to understand, hey, listen, I might be thinking this way, but that person is going to be completely different. I started to turn the corner and understand how to plug into people to get the most out of the experience for them. And so in a fire service, I had a lot of friends, 9/11 impacted our family. In that, I learned, you know, in a volunteer setting, how to inspire and motivate people. And there's no better way to learn that, right? And so if you're in a corporate world, a lot of times that's, you know, traditionally it's money or this or that and everything else. But you're in something that has a completely different purpose that's more meaningful to people. So I grew from that, and I use a lot of the fire service, honestly, in the work that I do today. And so we moved to upstate New York. You know, I left an executive position. And I just happened to be driving through Edmiston one day and noticed this campus that I thought was another SUNY school, which just happened to be New York Central. So I pulled in and applied. I was missing the corporate environment. This is my 18th year with the company, and we write property and casualty insurance. So your typical auto and homeowner and small business type of insurance. I was saying I got my start in underwriting. I also did a tour around the organization. They had me on a management rotation. Then they gave me the opportunity to build a team called Business Planning Analytics. And I looked after that for a while and then got promoted to sort of where I am in the position today. And I think, like Paul said, it takes a lot of things into consideration, the role these days for a CFO. A lot of different responsibilities. You might think it's just financial in nature, but there's other things that contribute to that growth, profitability obviously being two, and then investments as part of that equation. At first, to be honest, when I got here, this is a very traditional company. You know, people were like, oh, that's different. That didn't feel right. You know, it was very conservative, all those sort of things. And here I am, you know, like just with all this energy, I like to surround myself with people who are smarter than me. I know that's sort of upside down, but that's how I learn. I'm really sort of three different dimensions around my leadership. Very democratic in the sense that I like to empower people. I like to involve them because I get inspired when I see them grow. And honestly, I keep it so simple. I've been a football coach for years, baseball coach. And it's incredible. Really inside, I believe that we are all simple. I would also say there's an element where I am strategic, right? So I can get, you know, kind of pivot into that strategic role and be a visionary, that kind of thing. But I'd also say probably coaching. You know, here's what inspires me, an analogy, right? So I got the kid on the football field. I just was coaching him on how to do a few things on a play to make a big play. And this little tight end or this little defensive end goes back there and sacks the quarterback. And he turns around to the sideline, looks at me, smiles, and does this. And I'm just like, yeah, Johnny. And that's the thing. You just see like goosebumps on the kid, right? It's the same thing. It's no different in our world.
So you're this really relationship-oriented kind of leader. How did this COVID-19 pandemic help or hurt that leadership style?
That's a good question. Couple of things there. I think leaders are born in life. You're not born a leader. I think you're born in life. If you take the life experiences, you're like reborn each and every day with regards to how do you lead. And to me, leading is honestly, it's connecting. That's how I see leadership. So some of the organization was used to going home with a laptop, right? Operating from home, but 80% weren't. And so I think it elevated. It allowed me to do more of what I actually really enjoy doing. In order to look after employees first, sometimes you got to kind of put things in place to make sure that you could feel good about being able to do that and be and spend that time. So before this, I worked with a team to create what was called KPIs and a scorecard, which we look after. We issue it every month. And then what we did during this pandemic is realize, hey, how do we make sure we don't lose sight? First of all, we got to make sure the business is operating, right? we established that right out of the gate. What that did for us as leaders, for me specifically, was said, okay, I got one piece of paper I can look at and know exactly how the business is performing every week. That was a breath of fresh air. Did two things. For everyone in the organization, it helped them focus on the things that mattered most. What it afforded my colleague and I, especially Cheryl Robinson, was the opportunity to spend time with people. So we held huddles throughout the entire year. We went through the whole organization, having 20 people at a huddle at a time, and just mixing it up, engaging them, giving them insight into what was taking place with the business, how things were running, so it would put their mind at ease. When times are difficult, you need to over-communicate. And this isn't just 2x, this is like 5x during a time like this. And so that's where we spent our time. We did that, we did the huddles, we reached out, we connected a lot more with individuals through Zoom. You know, everyone's going through something slightly different. This wasn't the same impact for everybody. Born out of this experience, I think one, our leadership became even stronger than it's been ever before. We also discovered new leaders. We had a team called Incident Management, which also took a lot off of, you know, the CFO, the CEO. And so we grew in that dimension as well. I think when you think about it as a business, we grew in so many other ways. So we learned that we could do this thing called work from home. We also knew that what our culture represented, we have a North Star, which is part of our culture, that this could actually be something that enhances our culture, right? Because now across the board, you might've had leaders before that were doubting it, or that person wants to just work from home and perhaps they're gonna just, you know, not work as hard as a person. I think what's amazing here is I think people realize, oh my gosh, look at the numbers. We're making it happen. This could be a real benefit, offer great value going forward. So there's a host of things that we've learned through that experience and about people and also about ourselves and being able to trust. I think the leaders that are coming up now are seeing things quite a bit different than perhaps 20 years ago, that's for sure.
So what advice would you have to give to a new leader, like someone who may be leading a team for the first time, either in a remote or like hybrid environment?
My advice to you is always begin with trying to understand what matters to the other person. You know, like, so if you're leading a team, understand what's important to them. So you're the coach, you may have given them some insight here and there, but they are responsible for their success. And I always let every leader know that, right? You're not responsible for their success. You're responsible for their growth. Before you take anything out of someone's tank, you should make sure you're filling it 5 times, right? And so that could be, you know, it's mindful praise, right? It's a simple thank you. I often, sorry, I'm sharing these quotes and things that I've shared with other leaders before, but, you know, having worked for British Airways, right? I used to fly to London a lot. So a 1 degree course change can change your life. 1 degree. If you change course 1 degree when you left port in London headed for New York, you'd end up in Florida. So think about how significant 1 degree of change is. And so don't try to flip a switch and change who you are. Just try and understand those things, like I mentioned before, about what's important to others and put them into practice.